Welcome to this video in which I would like to present some selected highlights on the video series on our successful future. The other videos explain in detail all the assumptions that are made to come to the conclusions and also many more interrelations. Here I really only want to focus on some few results and only very some few interrelations. Well, what's the starting point? Starting point is, so to speak, the background that we realize the carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere is increasing as a function of time. In blue, you see the historical data. So if we don't change anything, it is expected that the development will follow this orange line. And there we see that the climate goals that we have, that we agreed on in the Paris Agreement, that they will be reached in 20 to 30 years, the 2 degrees centigrade goal here, and what you would like to achieve preferably the 1.5 degrees centigrade goal also here. So actually, if we don't do anything, we will reach these climate limits in 20 to 30 years. In turn, this means that we are left only with some few decades in which we have to change our entire energy system in order to reduce the CO2 emissions into the atmosphere. If you want to discuss scenarios of that looking into the future, one basic number for that is the number of people in the world, the world population, which is presented here in billion as a function of time. The historical data are shown here, and these are future projections. Now, one clearly has to say we can't predict the future, so we can only give scenarios that embrace, so to speak, a worst case and an optimistic case. Then we have the good basis for political decisions for a successful future. Now, I argue in the lengthy versions of the presentations that the UN predictions of the medium variant, that is more or less a lower limit. But since the UN is always updating these values to higher values, every 2 years they are updated and they are continually moving upward, one can extrapolate, so to speak, that tendency and see where we wind up if that is, so to speak, followed, if such a meta-study shows then where we will be winding up in the end. And if we do that, we wind up with this red line. There we see that in 2050 we will have possibly, as one possible future, 11.6 billion people instead of the usually assumed 9.8 billion people. Compared to today, these 9.8 would be roughly 2 billion more people than today. Here, there would be almost another 2 billion people that we have to account for. So I think that this is the expected range within which scenarios about world population can develop. Unfortunately, the studies that are available for policymakers, they are actually assuming much lower population growth. The EU is more or less the highest value, so they are not that bad, but they only use the medium variant. They don't use a worst-case scenario. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, in their recent report, use these data, so even less than that, and the Club of Rome is even below that. And there we see actually that all these scenarios are below what is to be expected. That means the number of people is less than is to be expected. The foodstuff that we need to feed these people is less than possibly will happen. The land area that we need to feed the people is less. And that means in these scenarios, we have too much land area available for bioenergy or for afforestation in order to recover the CO2 from the atmosphere. If population develops as more realistically expected, then actually that land area will not be available because we first need to feed the people, which in turn means that the energy transition, the sustainable energy transition, will be much more challenging than is assumed by these studies. Okay. At the same time, we have to realize, of course, that we first need to feed the people. That means the question of world hunger is really a significant issue, as we will see later. Now, how can we manage the sustainable energy transition? In order to characterize that, I plot here the CO2 production, which of course stems from burning the fossil resources, using that energetically and releasing the CO2 produced in the atmosphere as a function of time. The historical data are here, and this is the projection if we don't do anything. I show here three scenarios that embrace again these three scenarios which lie in the range of the climate goals that we have, somewhere between 2 and 1.5 degrees centigrade. If we want to reach the 1.5 degree centigrade goal, then we would need to finish the sustainable energy transition by 2050. If we think we could live with the 2 degrees, then we have to finish somewhere around 2075. Now, so it works. We can manage. Of course, this means that we significantly have to increase our efforts to establish more sustainable energy technologies on large scale. But we see directly from this diagram also a variety of other aspects, namely that there is a maximum through which we are running in the future, which means actually that it is to be expected that in the next 3 to 10 years, the CO2 emissions are still increasing. And the reason for that is simply that we are slowly increasing only the continual implementation of renewable energies. And at the moment, the world population is growing faster than that, and the countries are developing faster than that, so which of course also means more energy consumption, so that the increase in energy consumption every year is increasing faster than we are able to build up more renewable energy technologies. That will only be inverted, this relationship, in 3 to 10 years. On the other hand side, if you run through the maximum, apparently after that we use less fossil resources, which means that they are getting cheaper. And that induces quite interesting economic effects, which I discuss in more detail in the longer videos. The economies will become much more vulnerable than they are today. So through these vulnerable times, when actually the demand is decreasing, which typically leads to a decrease in price, so the fossil resources will get cheaper, we nevertheless have to keep up our intense efforts to implement sustainable energy technologies, even though the fossil resources are getting cheaper, through these economic difficult times where we have to rebuild large fractions of our industries, the energy industries, the cars have to be electrical cars, so automotive industry, chemical industry, the input can't come from oil anymore, it has to be coming from biomass or CO2 from the atmosphere. And also we personally have to have the economic power to buy electrical cars, to change our heating systems at home from gas, oil or whatever to electricity. Yeah, so there are significant changes that we are facing, also economic challenges for us individually, which we have to master through these economically difficult times. That's also part of the background. Now the question is, of course, how much do we need to push sustainable energy technologies? So this is plotted here in this diagram, where I plot the substitution rate versus time, where with substitution rate I characterize how much primary energy supply is substituted by additional solar and wind energy in 1 year. So how much additional solar and wind energy technologies do we implement in 1 year relative to the primary energy consumption in that year, expressed in percent per year. So how much percent of the primary energy supply are substituted in 1 year by wind and solar in this case. For the world, these are the data, so we are currently at roughly 0.5% per year. And in the scenarios that I've shown before, I assume that we have 2% if you want to reach 2 degrees centigrade, and we need to reach the 3% substitution rate if you want to manage the 1.5 degree climate goal. That is, we have to get from here, increase that by a factor of 4, even 6, if you want to reach the 1.5 degree centigrade goal, which means significant more effort that we need to take. Now the question is, of course, how fast do we need to do that? And actually, that one can describe that as well. Here the minimum required substitution rate is plotted versus the year when we increase our effort. So if we stay at a low level of substitution rate and only in some years decide to increase our efforts. If increasing them today to reach the 1.5 degree climate goal, we need, as I just mentioned, around 3% per year substitution rate. But we see if you wait 1 year, 2, 3, or so some few years, we see that substitution rate that is required to nevertheless reach the climate goal is increasing every year. For the 2 degrees, it's not so steep yet, but the last IPCC report indicated that we should keep the temperature increase as low as possible, and also for temperatures that we reach slightly above that, the curves are still quite steep. And actually, I believe this 3% are the limit, so if we don't start now, we will not be able to reach the 1.5 degree centigrade anymore. So negotiating about how we bookkeep the CO2 is not the right politics. We need to really start energy transition now. We see also that the population has a small influence, it's not that big, so that's only a slight modulation of the results, more or less. If you would wait, for example, 5 years in this case, instead of the 3% substitution rate, you would need to apply 4% subsidy or reach 4% substitution rate and maintain that for some decades to really manage the sustainable energy transition. So we have to start now. The second question that I wanted to discuss is the undernourishment or the hunger in the world. And we discussed it also concerning the land areas that we need, the world population and the land area required. And we first, the situation where we are in, so the number of undernourished people, according to some UN statistics, as a function of time, we see that since 1990, from 1 billion people, it has been reduced, meanwhile, down to 800 million, which means more than every 10th person is undernourished, is hungry now on this planet Earth. It's not a projection to the future, this is here now. The goal is actually, the last United Nations Sustainable Development Goal is to reduce or to eradicate hunger by 2030. And we see if we continue as we performed in the past, we won't reach that. So the question is, how can we reach that? In order to characterize that, I want to present how we use the land area. And this is shown here. It's expressed in land area in square meters per person. So taking the overall land area available, different categories, divided by all the people that we are. And since world population is growing, the area per person is decreasing over time. Arable land, meadows and pastures and forests are those land areas that I consider here. And the white lines distinguish them, and the white lines into the future are calculated simply by the available corresponding land areas divided by the increasing number of people that we have to expect according to the different population scenarios. Here I use that highest scenario in the world population slide, the upper limits, the worst case limit, so to speak. And then I account here for the different uses of the land area, the requirements for land area, for plant-based food, for biofuels, for biomaterials, feedstuff, and pasture. And there we see actually that we have to exceed the white line. So we have to cut down the forest, so this is the line distinguishing the current value of arable land in pastures and meadows and pasture, just accounting for an increased world population. So here we have to cut down the forests in order to feed the people sufficiently. So if nobody shall be starving, we have to cut down the forest. That's one option. Of course, not a good option, apparently. So the question is, what can we do? And there are two aspects, of course. On the one hand side, we can decrease population growth, use the different population scenario. And the second aspect is also quite relevant. If you look at that in a little bit more detail, we see that, of course, the feedstuff as well as the pasture, so this large area here, land area, we are using to produce globally just 17.5% of the calories that we supply as food. This large area for 17.5% of the foodstuff, and this small area for the plant-based food, that's for the other 80% of the foodstuff, of the calories in the foodstuff. That is, animal-based food production is extremely land area inefficient. If you want to increase the efficiency, we need to get rid of animal-based food and substitute that by corresponding amounts, of course, of plant-based food. If we do both, decrease population growth as well as shift to purely vegetal nutrition and this transition in food that we eat, as well as the energy transition being realized completely by 2050, we reach this picture here, so to speak, where we have large areas now available for additional things that we can do. So this area is then actually freed from agricultural land so that we can use it for more bioenergy, for more afforestation, to recover more of the CO2 from the atmosphere, to ensure better biodiversity. All that area can be used for that. The first question is now, of course, if we don't do both simultaneously, but only do one of these things, that is, only decrease population growth and still eat animal-based food, or shift to vegetal food stuff, but stick with the high population growth, can we manage? And I show in the longer videos, no, we can't. So we need both factors, actually, and they are big factors in order to get this freedom of on our land area to supply all these things that we need. These factors, on the other hand side, are so high that we cannot expect that any technological advancement will, on top of those things that I have assumed already, allow us to save us the land area for these things. And I should mention, actually, I didn't mention that previously, to derive these scenarios for the land area consumption, I assumed actually that the land area productivity will be increasing as it did in the past, which is actually a quite optimistic assumption, because as soon as climate change will increase, for example, that may not be developing as optimistically anymore. I did the optimistic assumption for the, that means continual intensification for the plant-based food as well as for the animal-based food, for all these land areas that I mentioned here. Okay, so that means, of course, we have to do things, and this is not technology, apparently. That's our behavior. How many children we have and what we eat, that's our behavior. It's not technology. Technology is behind that. I assumed, as I just said, maximum improvement in the technology. And on top of that, we need, if you want to be to ensure sufficient food for everybody, we need behavioral changes. So the question actually is, if we see how we feed the people on the lower end of our world community, they get that, some cereals, some vegetables, some corn and carrots possibly, some coconut mash, so to speak, that supplies a little bit of fat, that's what they get. We in developed countries, myself, I'm vegan, so these are pictures from our kitchen at home. You see, it's a quite variety of delicious food. Very tasty, many things that are possible, so to speak, many, many more, hundreds more or less, or thousands if you like. Can we afford that? Is that ethical to use animal-based food, to eat animal-based food? If we know that if we do that, we are excessively consuming land area so that we force on the other end of the world community that we have to feed the people like this. So here we have to come to a conclusion, a societal, ethical conclusion, so to speak, if that is ethical or not. I, for myself, decided that. I am here. I don't need that. But of course, it's a society decision that has to then be formulated as an ethic, as a sustainability ethics. The second factor was decrease of the world population. Of course, one can elaborate on that a little bit as well. Presented here is the fertility in children per woman, or if you like, children per couple, as a function of the gross domestic product, so the economic power in US dollar per person and year for different countries. And we see that actually for if we exceed a certain value of economic power, then the fertility is around 2 children per couple. 2 children is sustainable. 2 parents are substituted on the long term by 2 children, but that leads to a stable world population. At the same time, we see that some countries are very high above that. And so if we don't have a high economic power, the number of children is significantly higher. If you want to get that down, we have to develop these countries so that they move right and automatically then will also drop with respect to fertility. So we need to develop these countries, of course, because we have possibly the economic power. It's important for us because the difference, of course, in income also means that there's a high driving force for migration. And of course, that should not exceed certain limits. So it's our own interest that we develop these countries. At the same time, which one should very clearly say, of course, we should welcome every individual child, because it's not the fault of the child that is simply born, it's the decision of the parents. But the parents cannot be proud anymore of having many children or have other reasons, so to speak. These arguments actually don't count anymore in a limited world. Now, after that, with that, I would like also to finish this aspect on foodstuff, of world hunger and behavioral aspects. I would like to summarize or work a little bit towards a summary. I plotted here 3 main actors in this entire system. It's us, the individual citizens, me and you sitting in front of the screen, the company managers and the politicians. Of course, it's confused a little bit by other players in the game, but these are the 3 that are directly, so to speak, interacting. We are electing the politicians. We are having demands which are then supplied by the corresponding companies. And what I want to show here is actually I want to stress is it's us who is deciding on our behavioral aspects, how many children we have and what we eat. It's not the politicians. And we cannot delegate, so to speak, our responsibility for our own decision to the politicians. It doesn't work. Also, our decisions, we can't delegate them to the companies. They supply only what we are asking for. It doesn't work the other way around. That has been shown in the past. Examples are available. And we are also the only ones who can really realize that our behavior influences the system such that we can reach a stable, sustainable development. It's only us who can take that into the focus and regard that in our own personal decisions, that is which we, so to speak, drive the overall system. With that, I would like to summarize. I made realistic assumptions about the world population, possibly a little bit optimistic ones for the land area productivity. I show also that other workarounds with respect to land area productivity, like genetically modified crops, are not really promising, at least until now, more productivity. So there is no major technological advancement to be expected beyond what has been assumed, so to speak. I've shown that we need to take a systems view, that there are interrelations using different uses, for example, for the land area, but these interrelations are quite straightforward. It's always the same land area we are asking for. We have shown that the well-being of us depends on the well-being of others, driving migration, decreasing population growth, decreasing the CO2 emissions in these countries, etc. That actually affects us directly as well. I have shown that the behavior is at least as important as technology if we take both the challenges, climate change and energy transition, as well as world hunger. But especially these behavioral aspects apply already today. Today, as I said, more than every 10th person is starving on this planet now. Thus, sustainability depends on us individually. And it's not only the politicians, but largely it is really us who is deciding, so to speak. And that means in turn that we cannot delegate our responsibility to the politicians. We are individually responsible, me and you. And then we can also say something about the corresponding grassroots initiatives like Youth for Future, or Fridays for Future, or Scientists for Future. They should mention that, of course, and not only demonstrate in front of the parliaments, but also realize individually that they are, so to speak, in the driver's seat and they decide personally what they eat and how many children they have and, well, how much energy they personally consume. I'm quite sure that many of them realize that, but I find it a little bit too little expressed in their media presentations that they have. Finally, one has to say that we don't have the right to just have rights. We have the right to eat meat. Why? If we see that on the other end of the world civilization, the people are using or eating only some basic foodstuff while we have the economic power to buy the meat, we have to negotiate that on an ethical basis, so to speak, and we have then to realize afterwards that, of course, these ethical rules apply to everybody. Yeah, that's the basic for good ethics anyway. Everybody is equal. Finally, I would like to hint you at some other resources if you're interested in the topic. On the one hand side, the other videos of the YouTube playlist with all the details. Then on this website, I collected some of the texts that explain that and also the graphics, Vision 3000 EU. And if you're interested in the more philosophical aspects, so why are we responsible? Because we have free will. How can we have free will if there are physical laws? These more theoretical aspects are discussed in this book. It's relatively dry and it's in German, so to speak. So if you're interested in these things, then you may have a look at that. And finally, I should mention that many of the slides that I have shown, or diagrams that I have shown, are also published in this scientific journal. ChemBioEng Reviews has been published in June 2019, so there you can also find more details on that. And with that, I would just like to say thank you. I hope to see you again in one of the other videos. And at the end, I can only wish you and me a hopefully successful and happy future. Thanks and bye-bye.